Hi everybody, so my name is Benoît Vidcock and I'm working at the BRGM, which is the French Geological Survey. And I'm also working with the École Normale Supérieure of Paris. And so the aim of my presentation is to show you how we use helicopter-borne electromagnetic survey to the understanding of the hydrogeological functioning of the volcanic island of Martinique, which is situated in the Caribbean island, as you can see on this map, and it's maybe 3 hour flight southeast of Miami. So water resource exploration on volcanic island is challenging as these territories frequently face high population densities with increasing water demands. And to improve the hydrogeological knowledge of this island is in fact a major objective to achieve a sustainable development of the water resource. But the hydrogeological functioning of this island is often little known and little studied. And as some of you, we also face difficulties in accessing study sites as the island has a lot of steep slopes, dense vegetation, and also a limited road access, as you can see on the two pictures representing the central part of the island. And on the coast, as you can see here, we have a lot of density areas. This figure shows you the complexity of volcanic deposits, and we have a wide dispersion of faces between the central part, the medial, the proximal faces, medial faces, and distal faces. And the specificity of Martinique is that only the central and proximal parts emerge. So this is a good opportunity to study in detail the geological structure and hydrology of the upper part of andesitic system. So our objective is to interpret resistivity data together with geological and hydrogeological data from geological map, boreholes, and springs. And I will present you today two examples. The first one in the southern part of the island and the other one on the west coast of the island. So we took advantage of an helicopter-borne survey conducted in 2013 with SkyTEM 304 system. The map shows you the 3,700 kilometers of flight lines with 30 meters spacing between each electromagnetic sounding. The red line are with 400 meters spacing along the north to south axis. And the green line are locally reduced flight with 100 to 200 line spacing because of particular interests such as landslide in the east part of the island, groundwater survey here, for instance, or geothermal application. So the first study is in the center part of the island. So you have on this map the flight line in yellow, boreholes in orange, blue, and red. And so we use TDM resistivity, total magnetic intensity, and also geological map and data, geological and hydrogeological data from those 30 boreholes. Here is a cross-section of the suspected geology with maybe seawater intrusion near to the Caribbean Sea. On the opposite, all the yaloclastite on the hill, and our aquifer is here. We just know that in blue you have the piezometric map, and we know that water comes from the hill to the sea, which is classical. And we also are lucky because in the F1 borehole, a very long duration pumping test was done, and with 15 months pumping. So here it's a quick view of the pumping test analysis, which allow identification of the flow regime. We use derivative log analysis, and we will focus on this part of the figure. At the beginning of the recovery of the pumping test, we have typical spherical flow, which means that we have partially penetrating well. Next, we have here on the two, we have radial flow to the well, which allow to calculate the transmissivity of the aquifer. Then we have here different flow, so it's typical, the slope of the derivative is typical of flow reaching a first no-flow boundary. And at the end of the pumping test, you have here the time of the recovery, we have typical linear flow, which is typical of no-flow boundaries between on each side of the borehole. Here you have the results also of the pumping test of the second well, which is situated here. It's F2. We use the same methodology. At the beginning, we have a small wellbore effect. Then we have radial flow to the well, small one. We then have linear flow to the well, which is characteristic of a well just near a major fracture, and then radial flow, which means that all the pumping flow go to this fracture, which is like a drain, maybe. And at the end of the pumping test, we have a typical slope of a characteristic of a permeable boundary. So that means that at maybe some hours of pumping, we have someone or a compartment with very higher permeability compared to the aquifer in which we are pumping. So what we learn from pumping test is that for F1, the aquifer is limited laterally, but with a very low permeable boundary on each side, and also that the aquifer is stopped by an overlying aquitor with some leakage effect. The F2 borehole, we have a flow characteristic of channelized flow also in a pseudo-vertical fracture close to a permeable boundary. When we compare transmissivity of boreholes inside the F1 to F4 compartment with the basalt or aquifer outside this compartment, we have a clear difference in transmissivity, and maybe because the F1, F4 compartment is more fissured or fractured. And it's the same for resistivity that you can see here. The resistivity of the wells in the F1, F4 compartment are lower than those outside of this compartment. So if we look at the resistivity map, here it's the layer 40 to 50 meters. Geophysicists identify discontinuities for each layer on electromagnetic data and mag data. That is all the discontinuities. Here you have the piezometric map measured at the end of the pump test. So it's a drawdown in each wells. And here you have the piezometric map during the F2 pumping test. So we clearly see asymmetrical drawdown cone following the structural orientation of the fault system identified with the geophysical survey. So this is a good evidence of compartmentalization of this aquifer. Here you have the two main or two representative cross section of the area from the northeast to southwest, so in this orientation. So we clearly see near here you have the sea, very conductive layer. You have here the seawater intrusion. On the opposite, you have the yellow clastites, which are very resistive, with a beautiful fault between yellow clastite and basalt. You have alluvium conglomerates, and we have our aquifer, with difference between resistive and less resistive that we link to more fracture or less fractured basalts. And on this figure, we propose a conceptual model of the aquifer highlighting the permeability, channelized flow, and compartmentalization of this aquifer. And we suppose that it is controlled by tectonically induced faulting and rock fracturing due to the subduction zone, which produces a lot of earthquakes and which is near the island, and the subduction zone between the American plate and the Caribbean plate. So this is our second study. We are here on the west coast of the island. We study three watersheds going from the higher elevation volcanic domes at elevation of 1,400 meters and going to the sea 10 kilometers downstream. On this map, you can see in green all the flight lines, in yellow the boreholes, and in blue the springs, and you have in white the cross section. In this part of the island, we have two main geological complex. In blue, the Mount Jacob shield volcano with formation between 2 and 5 million years, and in orange, the Carbe volcanic complex with geological formation between 0.3 and 2.1 million years. So we begin by calculation of water balance, and that water balance calculation shows the main key component of the hydrogeological cycle of the two higher watersheds. And it provides the first evaluation of the groundwater budget. And in particular, the most important thing is that we have here and here deep infiltrated water. So the question is, where goes this water? And how is the structure of the aquifer the extension thickness of our groundwater body? So here we just have a look at the piezometric level of the boreholes and of the springs, which with the distance to the sea. We clearly identify two main typologies of aquifer. Here, perched aquifer with springs located at elevation above 400 meters, and aquifer crossed by boreholes in the valley with water level close to the ground level. We begin to analyze the resistivity data by making comparison with geological log and transmissivity data of boreholes. And we have a look to the closest electrical magnetic soundings. So boreholes are located at an average distance of 35 meters to the closest electromagnetic soundings. We put away all those who are too far from electromagnetic soundings. And we look at the difference in elevation less than 10 meters. You have here the BR, its borehole resistivity. And you have the lithology and the age. And concerning springs resistivity, we took in the 3D resistivity model, the cells located upstream the springs, which we supposed correspond to the perched aquifer, and we manually extract the resistivity. So that's SR spring resistivity. So on this graph, we show a good correlation between resistivity and the age of the geological formation, showing that the older the formation, the lower its resistivity. We have age between 1 million years and 5 million years. And on the second figure, we compared the transmissivity of the boreholes. We calculate also the hydraulic conductivity. And we also have a good trend with an increase of permeability or transmissivity with age. So the older the formation, the higher its transmissivity. On this slide, we show cross-section. It's C2 here and C3, which goes from both sides of the valley. So it's interesting. We have on the upper part of the hill the younger lava flow, very with high resistivity. On the opposite, we have a huge conductive layer corresponding to yaloclastite. And between the two, we have one of our major aquifers, which is 2-alpha formation, here. You have a picture of the 2-alpha aquifer with highly fissure and fracture part, for instance, on this photo. And those one are the two cross sections from north to south, so crossing all the watershed. So we clearly identify the andesitic domes with high resistivity value and important thickness. We also see the yaloclastite with very conductive layer, and between these two formations, the aquifer with some boreholes crossing this aquifer. And we also see on this cross section that here you have the topographical watershed with limit here and here, and we see that the andesitic aquifer clearly go from this watershed to the other one, so a lot of water from this could go to this watershed. So we use all this data to propose this hydrogeological conceptual model, which put in evidence the key role of the geological structure and also of the volcanic dome to the groundwater flow, explaining where the amount of water, the deep infiltration of water goes. We also show the difference between topographical watershed and hydrogeological watershed, with a lot of groundwater going through the topographical limit. And this effect of difference between topographical watershed and hydrogeological watershed is also amplified with the presence of this lava dome upstream. So to conclude, with those two examples, we have a better characterization of the hydrodynamic properties of our andesitic aquifer, and we have new hydrogeological conceptual models at different scales. We also reveal that so the older the formation, the lower its resistivity, and the older the formation, the higher its transmissivity or hydraulic conductivity. And what's it's interesting is that the hydraulic conductivity increase with age seems characteristic of this andesitic type volcanic island, because on basaltic type volcanic islands such as Hawaii or Galapagos, we have an opposite trend with a decrease of permeability with age. And we continue, or we thanks to this study, we have new guidelines for addressing relationship between resistivity, geology, and hydraulic conductivity. That's what I show on these two pictures. And now our perspective are to continue interpreting this data. So we will begin to work on the Mont Pelée volcano, which is situated in the north of the island, with pyroclastic flow. So it will be clearly different from the andesitic aquifer. A good way should also to make 3D geology, geological or hydrogeological model. And as we are hydrogeologists, we hope finding money to make new boreholes to validate those hypotheses, and also to provide groundwater to the population. Thank you.